Welcome back, everybody, to game number two here between Balkan Bears and Alliance. Alliance managing to take game number one pretty convincingly, but Balkan Bears hoping to be able to even things out here in this game number two, as there is a lot on the line. The winner of this will be going to Austin, Texas for the X Games in the joinDOTA MLG Pro League Season number two LAN Finals, which should be a lot of fun over 3 days. If you guys are anywhere near Austin, Texas, want to be able to have some opportunity to finally watch some Dota. Really, there hasn't been anything in the South that happens too much Dota-oriented, so this is really your shot. Besides maybe traveling up to go see TI or something along those regards, but let's talk about the game number two draft here. Welcome in my co-caster, Nahaz, is going to be joining me. Nahaz, we're going to see a Queen of Pain finally make it into the pool.
Yeah, this is a hero that's been picked or banned in over 95% of 6.84 Pro Dota 2 drafts so far. She can run any of the three core roles. We've seen her mid, we've seen her safe lane, we've seen her off lane. Just a very, very strong hero in this meta. And another strong hero on the Alliance side, the Beastmaster, has made a resurgence in a big way in 6.84. He's 32-21 so far in this patch, and you're seeing a lot of teams now starting to pick this hero up in the first phase.
I'm actually feeling like Beastmaster has more popularity now than he really ever has in Dota 2. There was times where he was quite popular as an offlaner, sure, and we even saw early Dota 2 days that he was picked up mid, but this kind of, I mean, just his win rate is really what makes me feel this strongly about that. Beastmaster is basically stronger than he really ever has been.
I think that's probably right. I mean, you have to keep in mind the hero never really went away on the Chinese scene. There are certain Chinese teams that have continued to pick Beastmaster. But I agree with you, at least in terms of his widespread popularity. I think it's at an all-time high right now. And now, boy, I know against Alliance, Mad is probably in the top three Bane players in the world, and Loda is probably the second or third best Tiny player in the world. On the other side, though, you've got to ask, how does Gyrocopter get into the second phase of a draft? I mean, this hero has the most wins so far in this patch, and I mean, it's starting to not even be close.
Remaining. Yeah, the Gyrocopter has had some pretty good times in this new patch. Just the general meta changes plus the Rocket Barrage change. I mean, the Rocket Barrage change I felt was quite unnecessary.
Oh, it's crazy. I agree.
He was never a hero. Homing Missile got buffed so many times that it finally became a viable ability. Gyrocopter was a viable hero before Homing Missile was a thing. So the fact that you would buff one of his primary abilities, Rocket Barrage, felt like a little unnecessary. But then the meta changes just generally go towards Gyrocopter type heroes anyway. I'm surprised actually that we haven't seen a little bit more Luna picked up, as Luna and Gyrocopter once upon a time, as they fulfill such a similar role, were once upon a time the go-to heroes of the meta.
Oh, you're going to see that. I really do think you're going to see Luna come back. Burning and Silent now both have picked up a Luna and built mech on her, playing her as sort of like an alternative to Shadow Fiend, you know, in that way, and done very well in those matches. I mean, you saw that at D2L Season 4, I believe. Silent built a mech Luna and did very well in that game. So, yeah, Gyrocopter and Undying, by the way, is the other hero. They were actually heroes that were starting to trend up in popularity before 6.84 came along, and then both of them got pretty serious buffs. Visage as well, I think you can put into that category. All three of those heroes then got pretty serious buffs, and you're seeing a lot of those so far. This is a good draft, though, by Balkan Bears. I really do feel like this draft is just four very strong heroes, and it's a combination that's just very, very easy to play.
Radiant team ban.
Bristleback going to be the response here from Alliance. They're certainly going for some... They're not going for the most successful heroes in the current meta. Like, yeah, Beastmaster's seen a lot of play, but the fact that they willingly give up Earthshaker, Queen of Pain, Gyrocopter, I mean, this is looking almost like a dream draft for Balkan Bears, but at the same time, I feel like Alliance, despite the fact that their draft may look a little bit underwhelming compared to the Balkan Bears powerhouse lineup that they have so far, I feel like their lineup is very much specifically to address what Balkan Bears are running. You've got the Beastmaster lockdown versus both Queen of Pain and now the Gyrocopter. character who's susceptible to that stun that goes through magic immunity. You have the Bristleback, whose natural tankiness works quite well against these sort of squishier heroes that Gyrocopter and Queen of Pain as cores that Balkan Bears are going to be running. And they also have like kind of a limited amount of damage in some way. Queen of Pain runs in, pops her combinations, and then she's kind of done. And if Bristleback can provide, you know, a potential pipe or even just enough magic resistance to his own self to be able to survive through that, Alliance will be able to turn the fight after that.
Yeah, and I would probably assume that this is going to be a Lota on the Bristleback, but Admiral Bulldog does play this hero. It's not completely out of the question that we could see an offlane Bristleback. Although I think, yeah, the last time Alliance ran Bristle and Io was actually before Admiral Bulldog rejoined the roster. They ran it in a win early last month against Secret. So they're familiar with this hero combination, and it is Bristle and Wisp is 4-1 so far in the new patch. So definitely some potential on the side of Alliance. But yeah, like you said, I feel like the BB draft, let's just put it this way, Alliance has given up an awful lot to get what they clearly feel is a very strong combination of heroes.
The puck going to be banned away by Balkan Bears, so they are kind of assuming it's potentially an offlane Beastmaster, and they could have been running a mid-puck with a safe lane farming Bristleback. I'm kind of like, if this were any other team, I would have gone, okay, this is going to be a Wisp Bristleback dual lane offlane, but it seems like this is kind of more to the wheelhouse of Lota. The Bristleback hero, as you said, Bulldog has played it before, but it just seems more natural for Lota to play it. Spirit Breaker now picked up for Balkan Bears is going to give them their offlaner. So some early aggression, potentially a hero that is able to burst down the Wisp nice and quick, can address him pretty easily, and is generally good versus melee heroes simply because that charge is so powerful in teamfights.
Yeah, I mean, if it were any, like you said, if it were any other team, I would call it a little bit differently. I would actually not be surprised to see them pick up like a Lina here for PyCat mid, because he's just so strong on those burst damage heroes and send Beastmaster into sort of his old role in the offlane. But yeah, I mean, any other team, you certainly call the mid Beastmaster here. That's sort of the norm in today's metagame. But I really, Spirit Breaker could actually be a pretty serious problem. The hero is a very strong 1v1 laner.
10 seconds remaining.
All right, Alliance down to the last 5 seconds of reserve time to choose their finishing pick, and it's going to be a Mirana. All right, that's definitely not what I expected.
That'll be the PyCat hero, most likely.
That's, okay.
Whoa, PyCat. The load of farming Mirana. Okay. Wow, we haven't seen this in a long time.
All right, so we do go back to dual lanes. The Wisp Bristleback at bottom. We've got a Mirana Vengeful Spirit at top and a Beastmaster mid. It almost feels like Alliance is experimenting a little bit. We haven't seen a core Mirana or really a whole lot of Mirana at all lately. Most notable one being Sing Sing playing it in D2CL just this past weekend as a mid laner, but that was, for me, I felt like that was Burton United just throwing out kind of one of those surprise picks.
No, I've seen it. I've seen it at least one other time recently. I want to say it was Era on Core Mirana, but that doesn't sound right to me. Yeah, I mean, Lota hasn't played Mirana since mid-December. So this is a pretty surprising pick from Alliance. And I agree with you, though. I think this is the time, especially teams in this situation, in this region, the EU qualifiers are just going to be absolutely off the hook nuts. I feel like you're going to see a lot of experimentation from these teams leading up to that tournament.
For sure. And I feel like this is kind of the perfect scenario for you to experiment a bit against a team. You're already one game up in this best of three. You're very heavily the favorites for this series in the first place. And, you know, it's a perfect time for you to try out.
Okay.
Okay.
And by the way, they switched.
Yeah.
So it is going to be pie. All right. This is what I assume is going to happen. PyCat is a really, really good Mirana player. And they're going to put Lota on the Bristleback. And okay, all right, order is restored. I was going to be seriously thrown if they hadn't swapped that.
Except for the weird part where Admiral Bulldog is going to be playing mid simply because that's where the Beastmaster is going to end up.
But that's what they want to do. That's sure. what they wanted to be able to do when they switched up the roster. Bulldog is a fine mid player when he needs to be, and wow, look at this.
Yeah, the charge already coming out. They're going to try and catch Ake. The cast goes down. They do manage to get the poison, and the Fisher laid out. First blood will go their way. So a heavy amount of commitment by Balkan Bears does secure a first blood for Hook, as well as a bounty rune. That's going to be a super early bottle, despite the fact that Queen of Pain did not go for an early bottle build. So he's going to be super happy with his mid lane up against the Beastmaster.
Yeah, I actually really like Aki's decision there to run to the left instead of running toward Lota, anticipating the cast. I think if Lota and Ake both get caught in the cast there, that's potentially a double kill because you could have gotten a two-man stun from the Fisher. As it is, though, BB do draw first blood. And let's remember, I mean, their lanes are going to be strong in this draft, I think.
Yeah, I'm liking the particular the Bristleback versus the Gyrocopter solely because, hey, you just turn your back to him, you mitigate a lot of that damage, plus you're turning a lot of physical damage back to the Gyrocopter as well. The Wisp will obviously be able to keep you alive for the most part against this lineup, so I feel like their dual lane's going to be quite strong. And then the top lane is in a very obvious combination here. The stun into an arrow means that they can actually put a lot of pressure on the Spirit Breaker. If it was any hero but Spirit Breaker, I would say they would be able to have a couple of early kills here, but the Spirit Breaker's natural tankiness right. will allow him to survive a lot of the times. Middle lane, they do get a kill on Bulldog, man. It seems. Hook committed quite heavily and almost dropped, but look at his build even. I mean, that is a build that says, I want to get a kill nice and early. Doesn't even have the blink. Thanks to the Fisher out from the Earthshaker, they do manage to do so.
Oh, man, and he just put yet another point in Scream. I don't know if you saw that, but wow. he had 101, and he's at 102.
Wow, that's something. That'll help him clear through the boar pretty quickly. Maybe some of his thinking, just because he knows he's going to be feeling that harassment quite a bit.
Yeah, as Kuhn just barely gets out of the way of an arrow here on top. And yeah, I mean, you talked about the Spirit Breaker's tankiness. He does have 927 effective HP versus physical damage at level 1. It's by far the most of any hero in the game. But you know, even he is eventually going to get forced out of this lane. And you see he's still level 1 now, almost 2 minutes in.
Yeah, fortunately for him, he does get a bounty rune, which is pretty critical because he now only needs really one CS to be in range of one creep dying, and he will have his level 2, and at which point he can start rotating around and perhaps help out that middle lane even more.
Yeah. This, by the way, is a big part of why you're seeing Beastmaster be so big, is just the double boar. I mean, the double boar is so good in laning phases 1v1.
Yeah, certainly. And the boar's damage is pretty insane as well. Level 4 right. goes up to 60 damage. That's potentially 120 damage out from a unit that isn't even your hero. It just means that there are many opportunities for you to be able to harass out either enemy supports or the enemy 1v1. But you see a lot of this is usually the best way to deal with it. Just instantly lock on to the first boar when it comes out and try and kill it. That way you don't allow double boar advantage to the Beastmaster.
Yeah, meanwhile, we did have a little bit of an exchange there on bottom. A lot of abilities used, but I'm not sure that even with the three heroes now, they've let Bristleback get to level 3. He does have the second level in Quill Spray now. He's going to be leveling up his passive from here. I'm not sure that they're going to be able to kill Lota, even with three heroes here in the spot lane.
Yeah, I think the only way they kill him is with a Spirit Breaker. Like, if the Spirit Breaker TPs to bottom and they go for the kill there, the Kuhn is going to take some damage. He actually charges into the enemy. They do not have mana for a stun on Mad, so there isn't any real danger to be had yeah. there. They do TP up with crit, but it seems perhaps a bit unnecessary. Perhaps exactly what they need, seeing as they're not going to be able to contest bottom lane anyway. They might as well help out the Spirit Breaker.
Yeah, that's right. I really do think that one of these three heroes, I kind of thought it was going to be the Earthshaker Red and the Witch Doctor, does need to be getting something done around the map because I don't think they're going to be able to kill this Bristleback now in lane.
All right, 4 minute rune. Looks like Kuhn's going to be able to secure the top rune. Bottom rune's going to go to the Wisp per the usual. Got to fill up that bottle even more. Allow Lota to spam out. Double damage for the Man. Queen of Pain to be picked up. That's going to be an excellent rune to perhaps dominate the middle lane even further.
God, it is just so much easier to play Wisp now in this patch, and Flash is going to get going on here in the bottom lane.
Oh, they managed to get a good block off. Lota still has his back turn, and with Hook coming in, they're going to try and address the Wisp first, as they know Lota is stuck, and he will end up going down to Yapzor while Hook manages to claim the kill on the Wisp. Good killing spree already for Hook. as he rotates down to the bottom lane to punish the aggression out from Alliance, and Kuhn will take over that middle lane.
Yeah, and that's the solution. We said we didn't know if we could they could kill Lota off with three heroes, but you bring that overleveled Queen of Pain who had the earlier solo kill on Bulldog mid, and that's going to get something done. Really big fight there for BB early on. Yeah, this Queen of Pain is going to get she's going to be quite a bit ahead here going into the mid game.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, don't usually bounce over to net worth this early, but solely because of the high number of kills that he's been a part of, you can see he's 1,000 gold ahead of the Mirana. For 5 minutes in, that's an insane amount of net worth.
Yeah. And this is a game where Queen can do a fair amount of snowballing here. She does have the Roar to contend with in terms of single target lockdown, but Venge is pretty short range. Mirana arrows unreliable. She should have a fair degree of freedom of movement in these fights.
Yeah, you know, when the Kuhn is off map like this, when he's not being seen by this ward in lane, he can actually put pressure on the Beastmaster. Beastmaster right. can't actually move very far forward in lane, has to use just axes and the boar spamming out to be able to get CS, and there's always potential that he can rotate bottom as well. TP to that tier 1 tower and charge right through the lane. So even when he's off map, he's actually exerting a lot of pressure on these lanes, despite only being level 3.
No, that's a great point. I mean, Queen of Pain, she's definitely not the dominant 1v1 laner that she has been in past incarnations of the meta, but she's probably the hero that benefits most from strong roaming supports. Even a support like Spiritbreaker just being off map is enough to put pressure on her lane opponent. That's a great pickup.
Kuhn, looking at the eventual Spirit, but perhaps wanting to be able to gank up middle instead, sees Admiral Bulldog. He has vision to be able to make that charge, but is just setting on the rune instead. We'll be able to save. Nope, not. Can't save that one. He's going to be hit by the arrow potentially. Pycat holds off on it, knowing that the Queen of Pain is going to be making his way over. And Matt is actually going to be the target instead, and they will be able to pick up this kill too. They leave him to dead. Alliance don't even rotate a single hero towards him, as they know it's obviously pointless.
No. When Pycat turned away from that, that is the same thing as making the decision to sack Mad there. And it's probably the right one because Pycat is still pretty squishy at this point, only has the one level in leap. Hook can kill him pretty easily.
First rotation gonna come out from Bulldog. He's been sitting pretty far back in the lane, so this is going to come as a complete surprise here to Balkan Bears, who will have their gyrocopter caught out. Lota starts making the run forward here. Mad's going to join them as well, trying to get a secondary kill perhaps. Exist easily goes down, and Grit does get caught by the stun out from Mad. So this pickoff is going to turn from 1 to 2 potentially. Never mind. They don't want to charge in, as they are actually being the ones charged here. Ake managed to get ahead of that scream. Mad will go down, though. Pycat pops the ultimate to make sure that the rest of Alliance does survive. A one-for-one trade-off there to the favor of Alliance, particularly since, whoa, the Kuhn. I thought he would have canceled that charge a lot earlier, but
that could easily have been another kill there for Hook. I think they misplaced the Fissure a little bit. Blink was still on cooldown, and Quap was blocked in by that Fissure.
Yeah, certainly, and they probably could have blown that Sonic Wave a bit earlier as
Exactly. No, I think he got a pretty good one, but I think, yeah, he was waiting for kind of the perfect one. But, yeah, meanwhile, I mean, Alliance do get something done, but there's the immediate response. And, I mean, this is almost the opposite of the last game where we saw Alliance take a 2K gold lead super early. BB are getting a lot out of this laning phase.
A pushback. No completed charge there. This is one of the great things about Spiritbreaker. Oh, God, the arrow is actually going to be able to land on a Pycat, though. Gotta reconsider here. That's not a fight he wants to be able to take. He grabs a haster and away from Hook and will be able to get some distance. Hook with only the level 2 blink will not be able to catch up. That being said, the Kuhn will. And he'll close the distance soon enough, but unless he gets an immediate bash to follow this one up, I'm not sure if they're going to be able to get this kill. Finally, it connects. The stun doesn't actually go out. No bash to the favor of Kuhn, and now he's going to be the one going down, potentially, as there is a level 4 Star Storm ready to go on Pycat, but they don't even need it. So they just run him down with the Spirit Balls. Pycat is going to force Hook back here, trying to make sure he protects his wits as best as possible.
Oh,
Hook actually
goodness.
Makes the commitment here, and Pycat now has the opportunity to be able to turn, but never mind, the Fissure actually hits him. He's going to have to make a leap away at the last second. Arrow ready to go. Hook thinking about making that blink, but we'll decide against it. Arrow goes out. Will not be able to latch. And a very favorable exchange there for Balkan Bears.
Meanwhile down bottom. Okay, they're all right. Exist is going to be able to get away from that. But I mean, the first thought that went through my mind in that fight is it ever accurate to say that a Queen of Pain mans up? It sounds wrong. So it sounds wrong somehow, but she totally did in that fight. I mean, Hook just about went ham. I was half thinking that she was going to dive into Piecat under the trees there above the Tier 1 tower.
Yeah, it kind of felt like he was considering it, but they do lock Exist behind this Tier 1 tower. They know he's level 5 as well. They'll clear through some of these trees, not hitting him just yet. Rocket Barrage, a little bit scary. They don't want to take that one up. The arrow will come in from downtown, easily being able to help out. The kill on the gyrocopter, commitment from 5.
I'm not sure they needed to commit the roar there.
Yeah, Kuhn's going to be charging in. They do have a Fisher laid out. Matt does manage to get ahead of that one, fortunately. They know Gyrocopter is not here with Admiral Bulldog cutting in through the side. He gets a good set of axes, which may just win the fight for them. Those three hits. Nice. Hook almost dies just to the Spirit Balls. As Hockey now charges forward, they'll be able to get crit. Jump forward. Yapzor managed to get another good Fisher with a Sonic Wave over the top. Echo Slam. Hello. 2 down, 3 down. Alliance still up, though, with their 2 cores. Going to try and chase down Hook. They do manage to get the Star Storm, the extra hit. It lands on him. Kuhn going for the kill on Piecat, but not able to catch up. Buyback. They're going to try and chase down Loda, but he already has his back turned. Hook is not going to have enough damage, and the buyback is not worth it for Hook.
Yeah, I mean, I thought that Alliance may have given that fight away, committing the roar to the gyrocopter, who's probably dead anyway, but I mean, they're able to come back, and they can threaten you.
Oh, Ake is going to fall here before he can get off the invisibility room.
I thought Ake was going to be able to just be invis and kind of hanging on to Loda as Loda pounded on him, but nope, the fade time, they still got him.
Three-man smoke up, Alliance blowing a lot of smokes
here pop it at
early
all.
On. Looks like they're really trying to utilize this mid-Beastmaster to pick off the gyrocopter as best as possible, and they know they can shut down the gyrocopter. This game is going to be kind of theirs. The pick-off easily there, and they can take over this Tier 1 tower as well. The problem is, yes, the Queen of Pain got a lot of farm, but they're not focused on shutting down the Queen of Pain. They say, fine. Quap's going to be a big factor, but there's only so much she can do as a hero. Instead, we'll keep the Spirit Breaker, who's already shut down just from the laning phase, at bay, and we'll make sure that the gyrocopter doesn't get anything. So by 5-manning, they're keeping the Spirit Breaker from being effective, and they're also killing the gyrocopter at the same time.
No, that's, I mean, I think that's a perfect analysis by you. Gyrocopter, the only hero that BB really has that's a dedicated damage source. I mean, obviously Earthshaker can do huge amounts of damage to his combo, but other than that, Spirit Breaker and Queen of Pain, more kind of 1v1 or small skirmish type heroes. And Alliance do have a team that has some death ball potential.
And they have a nice stack here for the Bristleback to farm up later. In fact, I say later, but with the minus armor that they have and the sustain, they can actually do it fairly early on. They've got Wild Axes to help do some damage to the Ancients. They've got minus armor plus physical damage out from the Quills and the Vengeful Spirit hit. They can do this right now.
Yeah, the Snot alone. No, that's they're going to take this stack fairly early, and I would, this is the right move by BB. You saw how aggressive they were with their smokes in the last game.
Yep, they're going to be able to catch Mad here. The ultimate goes out for the Marana, doesn't hit anything. Oh, the Kuhn does get snagged by an arrow, but that's the last hero you want to target. It seems like jump in, Hook is going to be able to finish off the Wisp nice and quick. Loda, meanwhile, trying to get himself away. Kuhn does end up going down to the Quills. Hook may also fall as well. He's got to blink up in 3 seconds, but it's not going to be in time. The right click out from Loda. Meanwhile, Piecat locks him in with Bulldog. If one support down, Echo Slam is up, but Yapzor says not the time to pop it. He knows he will not get a kill out of that one. Sure, they instantly kill the 2 supports of Alliance, but the core's still very much healthy, and this is exactly what they were thinking when they picked up the Bristleback. His survivability, him being able to last through these team fights, ensures that he can turn it around after the nuke damage is there.
Yeah, I mean, even the Beastmaster, before even completing the Necrobook 1, sitting at 1k HP, I mean, the question for BB in these fights, once they blow the Earthshaker ulti and the Sonic Wave, where's the damage coming from? You saw in that fight, you know, Queen of Pain with a decent Sonic Wave, but really only got one hero in the thick of it, and the damage output from there was just not enough to bring down the Alliance heroes. You get everybody low, but you can't finish the deal.
Yeah, as long as they can focus, either get the Queen of Pain or more probably more importantly, kill the gyrocopter in the beginning, there is no follow-up damage. Like, a lot of follow-up damage would be the rocket barrage spamming, but gyrocopter's usually dead or forced back. But after the first rocket barrage, they do throw down a call down. Matt is going to be caught by that one with Fisher and the poison. They'll clean him up. The charge on the Lota will complete. Arrow goes out. Not going to hit anything. Lota is blocked up a bit, but he's still got a Vanguard. He is very, very tanky. They're going to try and still go on him. The lockdown on the hook. Come too far forward. The rest of Balkan Bears didn't like the idea of that fight. Flash, he's actually almost finishing out the Courier. Doesn't quite get it. The Spirit Breaker charges away farther down. Piecat looking for the kill on the supports, but they both dodge the arrow, so they will survive. In the end, they lose the support, but they get a Queen of Pain. Alliance are happy with the way that fight went.
Oh, beyond happy. I mean, that's the hero along with Gyrocopter that you've just got to keep down in this match. And you almost feel like Hook at this point, as good a game as he's had to get here, I mean, he's almost got to have Admiral Bulldog on his radar at all times, because if he gets a chance to roar a hero, it's going to be that Queen of Pain almost every time.
Admiral Bulldog hit by the cask. Alliance looking to be able to push down this Tier 1 tower, but I don't think they're going to have the opportunity. Back to Bidding.
Oh, here they go.
Bears are going to try and take it to Alliance here. The charge goes out. Ron Ultimate pops. They get the stun onto the Coon. Admiral Bulldog's trying to get close enough. He doesn't actually have the roar. He clips him with the axes. That's not enough by itself. The swap goes out. Coon will end up going down. Nice combination. Plus they hit Hook with the arrow. That's going to be another kill.
And the Queen of Pain goes down as well. Oh, what a disaster.
Great arrow out from Piecat. Secures that kill. Flash now going to be the next target. A Fisher to keep Alliance at bay. But that will now be the Tier 1 tower that you're searching for all along.
Wow. Yeah, and that's... Boy, BB's chances just going downhill so quickly in this game. Alliance just following the recipe that you articulated so nicely a couple minutes ago. They're going to five-man, and here comes the relocate into mid for Crit.
Yeah, Crit's done for. He's got his cask, and he's got his ultimate, but it's not going to be enough to kill. Well, maybe it is. Heal up. No.
Is that the first relocate of the game?
Yes, it is.
I mean, 16 minutes in, with an Ake Wisp, this is how hard you're winning right now, is that 16 minutes in is your first relocate of the game for a solo kill on a Witch Doctor. That's either a very good game or a very bad one.
Yeah. No, we can definitely tell which one it is. They're now going to be able to take Roshan, 14-16 to the favor of Alliance, but the kill score doesn't say enough. As they are almost 10,000 gold ahead and 7,500 experience, the Roshan will definitely push them over the edge, and that's before they even finish up Necrobook 3 on the Beastmaster, and that's important for a reason. The Necrobook is an item that gets a bigger benefit. It's kind of like a gold sink at first, where you, like, a Midas.
Not as much now. That buff to the low-level Necro is big. Piecat might be going down here.
Yeah, he's going to die out. Spirit Breaker manages to get the right click there to get the kill.
I'm a little bit surprised that they didn't go ahead and put the Aegis onto Piecat's Mirana. I mean, obviously, a Bristleback with an Aegis is a nightmare to deal with. But, you know, Lota has been so tanky in these fights anyway.
Yeah, I mean, considering the fact he's had the early Vanguard and now almost has a full SNY, it seems like he's not going to die with this Aegis unless they just make very, very heavy commitments.
But I think we should make a point here. I mean, as you brought up a minute ago, Bulldog finishing up his Necro 3, I think we should bring up a point here that we made in the last game as well. And that's, you know, gold leads, they tell an important story, but they don't tell the whole story. A 10K gold lead on a lineup like Alliance have in this game that is so mid-game focused anyway is a very different thing than the same gold lead on maybe a more laning emphasized lineup or a late game focused lineup. I mean, Alliance have what they need to just take total control of this game right now.
Matt is going to go for the swap here on to Crit with Beastmaster right on top of him. They don't even need the Primal Roars. They just lock him down with one stun, and the Necronomicon minions do the rest of the work. The SMY completed as well. They'll get the Tier 1 tower, and with that Necrobook 3 up and all the Aegis and everything else that's going the way of Alliance, you're going to see that gold lead drastically start falling as they start taking the rest, well, this last Tier 1 tower and the Tier 2s as well. And there's not many options that Balkan Bears have when it comes to split pushing because they're facing up against a Wisp.
Yeah, and I mean, they're desperately trying to get exist some room to do something in this match. You can see he's got the Ogre Club trying to come back and build that. Well,
relocates up. The TP's already there. Bulldog will catch Exist before he can finish his TP. Good coordination there from Alliance. They're actually going to move forward here. The Murana ultimate is laid out, so they can't actually catch the Wisp and Bristleback. I don't think, nor would they really want to. As they TP back in, or relocate back in, rather. The charge is coming up to top lane, but that leaves perhaps the rest of these supports exposed. Kuhn actually cancels his charge.
Yeah, you can't do that. I mean, if Bulldog is willing to take the foot off the pedal for a second and just push that top lane, I don't think you can be too aggressive in this situation. The remaining Alliance heroes are positioned to just hurt you so badly mid lane.
All right, tier 2 tower probably going to be falling here soon. As Alliance still have another 2 minutes on that Aegis, and I doubt Balkan Bears are going to take a full 5-on-5 with that kind of power. They even have the medallion laid out for Loda, so he can take up. Oh, Yabzor eats an arrow. Pycat thinking about making that commitment, but they say it's not really worth it. I can understand that one. Pycat manages to leap away, brings the cask with them, though. They get the tier 2, and it looks like they're going to ping out the tier 2 at bottom lane next, as Alliance might as well make use of the last remaining minute of the Aegis.
Yeah, it's at this point you start asking yourself, you know, Gyro's not even to BKB yet, much less a damage item. Bristleback with that medallion buff is getting almost 50% resistance just from his armor. Forget about his passive. I mean, how are they going to bring down Loda in these fights? It's going to have to be the perfect combo between the Earthshaker and the Queen of Pain with a fully channeled ult from the Witch Doctor for BB to have really a chance to do anything in these fights.
Tier 2 tower is going to fall here. Alliance, they're not feeling much threat from Balkan Bears. Balkan Bears are doing the only thing they can do, which is push out middle and top, but at the same time, they still have to be scared of relocate, so they can't even push out that aggressively. Well, Queen of Pain can, but not really anybody else.
Yeah. I may be the last one left, but I still really like this Drums Maelstrom build on Murana, even with Drums of Endurance being nerfed like 40 times. I still really like the progression of that build.
Yeah, you still see Drums all the time just because it's like, what other item are you really going to get? The SMY replaced it, I think, for a lot of core heroes, but...
Oh, initiated onto Loda here, but yeah, look at that. I mean, he just takes no damage.
Yeah, if you don't manage to stun him with his back turned away from you, then you're not going to go for that kill, that's for sure. So the moment Loda turns around, it's like, well, that fight's over. Looks like we're going to have a Scotty out from Loda as his next item.
Goodness gracious. Yeah, and I mean... A Scotty Bristleback and Matt is probably going to go Solar Crest on it as his next item. I mean, that hero is just going to be able to stand in the middle of BB and just, you know, what's up, guys?
Yeah, and Mech on Ake, soon to be followed by Guardian Greaves when he can get as well. You've got the
Greaves on Io is just so nuts.
Yeah. You've got the Beastmaster Aura as well as the Necronomicon summon units Aura as well. Kuhn, oh boy, they're going for a serious charge here. They get a three-man Fisher. The cooldown's going to be able to lock down three. But Loda charges ahead. Minus armor onto Kuhn allows even the tanky Spirit Breaker to fall pretty damn quickly. And the rest of Balkan Bears now on retreat, but Hook actually gets caught. Bulldog gets off his ultimate. Yabzor throws out a Fisher, but not in time to save his ally. And may not even be in time to save himself. They have to relocate forward. Crit gets him. Oh, Exist gets hit by the arrow too. It's almost a wipe. It's only Yabzor who survives. Alliance will now push down middle.
Yeah, I mean, I think we are fully into garbage time right now. This game just got nigh impossible for BB, and this is the difference. You saw Alliance make some good plays and get ahead in the early game in our last match, and then maybe make a few mistakes. Alliance just haven't made those mistakes in this game.
For sure. Buy back out for the Queen of Pain, and we'll wait out the Gyrocopter and the Witch Doctor before they commit for the fight. But by that point in time, I mean, with this build, particularly on the Murana, there's even more synergy with the Bristleback. You talked about all the increases in damage and survivability he has between the Wisp, the Beastmaster, the Minus Armor, or it just goes on and on and on. But now you have a Mjolnir Static Charge that's going to be placed on him as well.
And he's going to go Octarine, too. Bat me.
Oh,
my goodness.
Nice.
What a, like, Lotus saying to BB, just try and kill me, guys.
Yeah, that's going to be rough as all hell. As that. So the 25% reduction is going to take a full second, almost, off of the quill spray. Right. So it's, what, 2.25 seconds or something?
Yeah, it ends up being right now. Yeah, it ends up being displayed as, like, yeah, 2.25
seconds. Okay, wow. Comes in with a save, and now they're going to make the turn. Crit's going to be the first to fall here. Loda takes the Maledict like it's nothing. We'll move on to Till Kuhn as well. Godlike spree. Oh, man, that was some commitment from Balkan Bears, and they couldn't even get the kill.
They go on Pycat right now because he's really the only core on the side of Alliance that they have a realistic shot at killing, but forget about it. I mean, the save by Aki, and he's been doing that on Wisp for, you know, over 2 years now.
There we go. My shop was a little bit bugged out. I couldn't look at the Octarine core any further. But yeah, this is going to be it's going to be rough. I mean, the more Quillsberries come out, the more heal you're getting from them. I'm going to presume that this is also going to proc towards Bristleback Quill Sprays as well.
Yes.
It seems like
you get procs from
your Octarine
is really
well.
You get procs from passive. You got procs from items even.
Yeah, you can proc Octarine Core off of, I believe, Feast.
The weirder thing is I actually think Midas procs it, which is super.
Oh
weird.
Yeah, I've heard about that.
And there is a bit of disagreement because I'd been told, and I tested it and I didn't think it worked, but I've been told different things about whether Death Prophet spirits work with it. Because Simba, a fly, just said on Twitter that it actually does work with DP's ult. Which I was sure it didn't, but I mean, I'm not gonna disbelieve him.
Do you think maybe he's saying it works and that? No, that wouldn't. After it like comes back, but that doesn't make any sense.
No.
So.
He said flat out that you get healed from the exorcism.
I mean,
that's damage. Which
that's
if it's,
really important.
If it's true, she's back.
If it's true,
Death Prophet's back as a hero.
Yeah, I always thought that's the way it should have worked, but
I agree. I hope it's kind of a. I was hoping when he said that it was kind of a shadow fix, because that's when I saw the item, one of the first things I thought about. But anyway, BB are going to try and get a trade here top and pressure the tier 2 tower. I don't know that they have the sustain if Alliance chooses to defend this, but Roche is up, and Alliance might just choose to trade the big guy there for their tower.
If I recall, Death Prophet also got a buff on the level 1 exorcism.
Yeah, the number of spirits for both level 1 and level 2 got a buff. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's
which is really nice. I mean, the strength gain nerf was just in the last patch was so huge. I know people got sick of that hero, but I mean, if you play that hero in pubs, you just feel so much quicker now.
Well, we've got an Aegis now on top of the Octarine core on Loda. Another 1,000 gold behind him. Ake's got a mech, soon to be Guardian Greaves, Admiral Bulldog, with his Necrobook 3 and Blink Dagger that'll make the initiation onto exist, surrounding him very rapidly. Dominating spree now for Bulldog as they push uphill once again. Oh, Swap is going to be able to catch. Oh,
clutch
Blink. That teamwork almost caught Hook. It's one of those clutch plays you can do with the Ventral Spirit. To date, the best team that I have ever seen run that Ventral Spirit has been Virtus Pro with FNG. To date, it seems like he is just so good at communicating with his allies about how to get the instant swap stuns.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, FNG deserves credit for his play on a number of heroes. His tree is amazing, too.
Oh, hooked up. whoa, hook! Blinking aggressively, questionable. The arrow does manage to lock him down. Yapzor does manage to finish off at least one hero. Pycat drops low, but not low enough as Ake quickly heals him up with the mech. Meanwhile, Lotus right in the middle of everybody. GG, well played. Balkan Bears will drop down to the lower bracket. Alliance are going to be the second team going to Austin, Texas.
Yeah, and Loda was moving at 522 movement speed in that fight from Warpath stacks alone. The Bristleback from Loda just too huge in this matchup as BB do fall. And this is the Alliance that needs to show up to the TI5 EU qualifiers if they're going to take home the prize. Obviously, this team has the talent to do it, but there are just a lot of good teams in that region right now.
All right, guys. So that brings our night to a close. Two quick games to the favor of Alliance. Doesn't eliminate Balkan Bears, but does drop them to the loser's bracket, where I believe they will be facing, I think it's Vega Squadron, but I'm not quite sure. There is still Vega Squadron, London Conspiracy, as well as Ninjas in Pajamas, all in the lower bracket now, fighting over that last slot from the European qualifier to Austin, Texas. But that will be a story for another day here on the joinDOTA MLG channel. Hope you guys enjoyed the commentary. You can follow us at Dota Capitalists as well as at Nahaz Dota. Nahaz, you got anything else to add?
Hey, shout out to our viewers. We always appreciate you guys tuning in. And hey, go watch the Summit 3. They got a good one going.
Yeah, absolutely. A lot of great matches over there tonight. I know I'm definitely going to be watching that perhaps all night long. So thanks again, guys, for watching. We'll see you guys next time.